We're in the process of redoing our membership options. So if you're not a member of the Silicon Valley Space Center, we encourage you to become a member, and you get to attend all our tech talks at no extra charge. And then I'll also reiterate the Moon Watcher program. You should check that out on Kickstarter. So with that, I'd like to thank Gary Hudson as our guest, and Ann as well from the Space Studies Institute. Gary, I've known for several years here as one of the premier entrepreneurs in the space sector. If you've ever been down to Mojave, you've seen the rotary rocket that's down there. That was part of Gary's program. Gary is currently the CEO and president of the Space Studies Institute, which is a nonprofit. It was founded by Princeton University professor Gerard O'Neill, and its mission is to open the energy and material resources of space for the human benefit of our lifetime. So I think Gary always has a very unique perspective about the commercial space sector and entrepreneurial opportunities, and has also led some very interesting studies on the microgravity applications in low Earth orbit and alternative propulsion concepts. So with that, Gary, I'd like you to please welcome.
Thank you, Sean. No place to put a beer. Don't let me forget that. Well, thanks very much, Sean and Rick, for the introduction and the invitation to come here tonight. Unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, actually that's the case these days. I do very, very few talks, so this is a good opportunity to get the SSI story out in front of all of you tonight. So today I want to talk about gravity. I used to title this, what did I used to title this talk? It was, gravity's a weighty subject, these sorts of puns. But tonight I'm just going to say that it's the key to both life and transportation and propulsion on the high frontier. So the first part of the talk is going to, I'm going to spend just a couple of minutes on what SSI's background and history is for those of you who might not be that familiar with us. Then I'm going to talk about a project we call G-Lab, which I think is one of the most important, if not the most important, biological research activity we can conduct in space in the next century. And then I'm going to step off the edge into really advanced and exotic propulsion work that we're helping to fund and help build a community around propellantless propulsion, which I know very little about, being a rocket plumber and not a physicist, but I'm sure it will engage a lively debate. The first thing I want to say about the Space Studies Institute is this is our 40th year. That's what the little ruby and the 40 years down in the corner is all about. Gerard O'Neill, Jerry O'Neill, created SSI in 1977 to popularize his vision of free space settlements. He used to argue that the surface of a planet is not the right place for an expanding technological civilization because you're at the bottom of gravity well. And I and my colleagues share this particular point of view. So he felt that we should capture the resources of space, the physical and energetic, solar energy resources of space, by building space settlements in free space, like the L4 or L5 points of the Earth-Moon system. So our mission is not to be an advocacy organization these days. There are plenty of other organizations out there that do this, National Space Societies and the Space Foundation and so on and so forth. Our goal is to try and advance the technology necessary for permanent human settlement of space, and to do it as soon as practical. So our approach is to address individual technology gaps, because there's a lot of people working on a lot of technologies, so we don't want to replicate what other people are trying to do. We want to take on those things that nobody else seems to want to touch. So our legacy is a hardware legacy. As I say, it's not an advocacy legacy so much. And this illustration shows, or this photo, shows Professor O'Neill there with, and this is actually Eric Drexler, for those of you who are nanotechnology fans, Henry Colm of MIT and a group of other MIT students. And this is them building the mass driver in the mid-1970s that O'Neill was thinking of using to get lunar resources off the surface of the moon and into free space, into the L4, L5 points. And it could also be used to move asteroids as a propulsion device by slinging asteroidal material off the back end as an electromagnetic rocket. So they actually built the hardware. We still have some of that hardware in our office. We also worked on the Lunar Prospector mission that was ultimately launched by NASA and Lockheed. We did the initial design work and funded the initial studies with Lockheed. And that was launched, it was basically the first return to the moon since the Apollo era, and that was in the early 90s. And then over the decades, we've done 14 conferences which have resulted in published proceedings, generally published jointly with the AIAA. And these are available both online and as hardbound proceedings. And we continue that particular goal. We haven't done a conference, a space manufacturing conference, in quite some time, but we will be resuming those in the next couple of years. So when I took over the job, I'm the third president of SSI. I took it over from my friend and colleague, Freeman Dyson, who, as he approached his 90th birthday, started to wind down and only handle 200 or 300 outside jobs. Freeman had me take over as president in 2012, I believe. And the first thing I did is the organization had been fairly moribund under his leadership, I think because, number one, there were a lot of other space organizations that kind of sucked up the dollars and the interests, but also the hope and dream of space settlements of the 70s had faded with kind of the harsh realities of the 80s and 90s, and people were focusing more on commercial space than more grand visions. And I think that was all just part of the normal turning of and events that happened with brilliant ideas. They overplan or they overex. They basically are too optimistic in the short term and too pessimistic in the long term. What we wanted to do is bring back some pizzazz, if you will, to SSI and try and address an unmet need, which I think it's pretty extraordinary that we haven't dealt with this particular problem, and I'll speak to that a little bit more in another slide or two. But basically, we set up three programs. One we call G-Lab, which I'll talk extensively about. One that we call E-Lab, which is I'm not going to say much about tonight, but is an attempt to bring together all of the closed life support systems and concepts of the last 50 years into a system of systems type cohesive whole that you could apply to a space settlement. And then a third, as I said, really off the wall concept called the Exotic Propulsion Initiative, which I'll close this talk with. So why G-Lab? Well, U.S. national space policies, actually, believe it or not, from even 2010, says that our goal is the capacity for people to work and learn and operate and live safely beyond the Earth for extended periods of time. And this really struck me, ultimately in ways that are more sustainable and even indefinite. That's pretty extraordinary. That began with the Bush vision for space exploration after the Columbia accident in 2003, and was extended into the Obama administration in ways that are even indefinite. I mean, that's pretty extraordinary statement. So taking that as national space policy, then we looked at the decadal survey on biological and physical sciences that was done in 2011. And they keep, every decade, they keep coming back and saying, we need to study gravitational biology in space. And NASA says, thank you for your report, puts it on the shelf. And a decade later, they come back and say, we need to study gravitational biology in space. Report goes on the shelf again. And this has been the case pretty much since the dawn of NASA in the space age. So why is partial G research important? The reason is, when you look at this, this is health, this is gravity, going from zero G at ISS to the moon, to Mars, roughly a third gravity to Earth. We have no idea what the shape of this curve is. We don't know. We know that you could be at optimum health at 1G at Earth. We know that 0G is very dangerous for you. There are lots and lots and lots of changes that occur. None of them are good, unlike early science fiction writers who thought we might live forever in low-G environment. No, you're only going to live for a couple of years. Right? And most of us wouldn't survive a year in a low-G environment. So is this a linear shape? Is it one of these things where just a little bit of gravity restores you mostly to health? What is the shape of the curve? We do not know. $500 billion and a half century after the dawn of the space age, we do not know this most fundamental question about human existence in space. Can we live on any planetary surface other than Earth? So some people talk about us becoming a multiplanetary civilization. I won't say who, everybody in this room knows. These are the moons and planets of the solar system. This is the one that's got 1G. Venus, which, you know, I'm not ambitious enough to want to terraform, comes close. Mars is only 38% of normal G, the moon only 16%, and the Titan and the Galilean, two large Galilean satellites are about the same, about 15%. There actually are two places where you could survive at almost 1G, either just a little bit less or a little bit more beyond Earth. One, of course, is Venus, and as I said, nobody wants to terraform it, but you could live above the cloud decks of Venus. Watch that first step, however, because the sulfuric acid clouds are below you, and I imagine the smell must be pretty bad. But once again, you're at the bottom of a 1G gravity well. The other option is the cloud decks of Saturn, a hot air structure. If any of you remember Buckminster Fuller and hot air domes that would be levitated, you know, half-mile wide domes that would be levitated over Manhattan by just the hot air rising within the dome. Well, you could do exactly the same thing in the Saturnian atmosphere. I have a lovely, very tiny painting from Ron Miller, original Ron Miller, that shows the upper cloud decks of Saturn as viewed right in the ring plane. So the ring is just bisecting you, and the sun is moving behind it. There's a beautiful sun dog. I mean, it's a lovely sight. And I could imagine a floating city in the Saturnian atmosphere. Whether or not you could build a civilization at the bottom of that gravity well floating is another matter altogether. But those are the two places besides Earth, Venus and Saturn, where you could potentially get approximately 1G. Now, as I said at the outset, O'Neill felt that a technological civilization, especially an expanding one, should not operate at the bottom of a gravity well, that your heavy industrial capability your access to energy and raw materials and resources, you know, on a time scale of centuries and millennia, really need to be in free space. So this this curve shows you where we are here at the bottom of Earth, also where you end up at the bottom of the moon. Where you really want to be is here. There's plenty of resources there, from cometary debris to asteroidal material. You don't necessarily even have to do what Jerry was looking at, which is take material off the lunar surface and take it into to free space. You can access it directly. So this is what we would like. And when I say we, I talk about SSI and adherence of this particular non-planetary bias about moving off Earth. This is the Stanford Torus concept that was developed around 1975 here in the Bay Area at a summer study program. So this sort of mini ring world is it could support between 10 and 100,000 people. You could build one after the other. In fact, the first settlement, its revenue comes from building the next settlements. Right? And if you think that that's absurd, a friend of mine gave a talk a couple of years ago where he pointed out something that I had no clue about, which is that at the time of the American Revolution, New England farmers, you know, they would farm during the growing season, but then winter would come. What do you do when it's winter in New England? Well, it turns out what you do is you build ships. And 75% of the bottoms built in 1775 that were part of either the Royal Navy men of war or the merchant fleet of the United Kingdom were built in New England. 75% were built in the colonies. And that's for one simple reason, trees. There were lots and lots and lots of trees in New England and relatively little left in England. So those farmers would put down their plows and they would go into the shipyards and they would build ships. And so when people say, what is a space settlement going to do? It's basically going to build more real estate. And it's a self-perpetuating business. Anyway, this is the type of thing I think we would like to see. You know, what would we accept in the next 50 years? Well, Space Station 5 from 2001, that would be fine for me. you know, a kilometer in diameter, you know, several hundreds or several thousand people in space. We certainly, you know, when I saw 2001 when I was 18 in 1968, I thought this was 10 years into our future. You know, here we are 50 years later, and it's still 50 years into our future. So I like to tell people, this is what we can afford. This, of course, is Wernher von Braun, who I will really date myself by saying I knew. This is his rotating space station concept. But what we can really afford is the model. Not the real thing, okay? There's literally that little money going into any analysis of a rotating structure in space that provides artificial G. By the way, for those of you who were born after the Apollo landings, this little thing in his pocket, that's a slide rule. I still have mine. So we came up with this idea that we really need a G lab. We need multi-generational vertebrate mammal experimentation. And we need to see what happens when you impregnate an animal and raise an offspring to term, and then that offspring gets pregnant and goes on and you just keep that up for like 10 generations so that we can see what's happening in a long-term epigenetic analysis. So people have said to me, well, that's too ambitious. And I grant it is very ambitious. That's aiming at the stars, right? But they say, well, why don't you do something smaller? You know, fruit flies. It doesn't have a spine, okay? If it doesn't have a spine, if it's got an exoskeleton, I don't care about it. They say worms, you know, C. elegans. Well, they're worms, no spine, okay? No calcium metabolism the same way that we have calcium metabolism. So, you know, there's a centrifuge that the Nanorex folks in Astrium have put on board ISS. It's available, you can hire it out. The Japanese Space Agency cooperatively actually physically developed a 2.5 meter centrifuge for NASA to plug onto ISS. It was supposed to fly in 2005. You know where it is right now? It's rotting away in their parking lot at Tsukuba, Japanese Science City, because NASA didn't want to put it on ISS. And I'll get to the reason why. And people have looked at larger centrifuges as well, but those are just not going to happen. So this one, I think we have a little bit too much light here, but this one is too small for multi-generational vertebrates. This one, the Japanese one, or the big inflated one, is too big for ISS. And the reason is pretty simple. I mean, you've got to understand that ISS has got a big microgravity research component and, you know, a number of other things where pointing of the spacecraft is important. If you have a 2.5 meter, 1 metric ton centrifuge spinning on ISS and you have one of them, right, ISS goes wherever this thing wants to go. Okay, this is the largest momentum device on board the ISS. And so, you know, however it wishes to go through inertial space around the Earth, ISS is going to follow. And this upsets people. The vibration upsets microgravity experimentation and so forth. So it got killed. So you cannot connect a centrifuge to ISS. That's just not going to work. So we need a dedicated free flyer. So in 2012, I proposed this dedicated free flyer launched like on a Falcon Heavy or something comparable. It's about 5 meters in diameter. It is meant to have a human crew, either human-tended, man-tended, as they say, where you fly up to ISS and then you take a tug across to this thing, or have it come and not dock, but stand off like a kilometer or two from ISS where you could do a space-suited transfer. Exactly how you operate under these conditions, co-orbital with ISS, is all TBD. But something like this is necessary. Some sort of free flyer is required. So I looked at how you might go about launching this. And of course, the Falcon Heavy is one option. It's only 4 years overdue at this point, but I really can't blame SpaceX for that. They've had a lot on their plate. But now we have a competitor in Blue Origin, which has even a larger vehicle, the New Glenn, which can carry more than a Falcon Heavy and a much larger diameter. This is a Skylab equivalent diameter up here, 22 feet, 6.5 meters. So we could imagine a situation where a free flyer that's got multiple centrifuges, so you have contra-rotating ones so you can deal with momentum balance and so on. You've got storage decks, you have a docking deck, and you have a habitation deck. So this could be permanently crewed if you want to do that. And I looked at what this might cost. It's not cheap. It's cheap by any NASA standard or any government space standard at, we think, about $200 million-ish dollars to do, sort of a SpaceX-y style operation. But that does not count launch, and it does not count operations. So we figured some sort of public-private partnership where, you know, somebody launches it, some government launches it, it goes up on an Ariane 5 perhaps, like the Webb Space Telescope, and then it is serviced cooperatively by other space agencies like the Japanese or Europeans or NASA. Now, having a co-orbital with ISS means anytime a Dragon, a Progress, a Soyuz, or whatever ends up docking to ISS, it could be carrying cargo and supplies and material for this core orbital station, because from a delta V standpoint, from a change of velocity standpoint, we're talking a few meters per second to go from ISS to a co-orbiting station that's maybe in trail like 20 or 30 kilometers for safekeeping. So there's, you become a destination, almost like an industrial park that you can just visit on a routine basis. But I figured that wasn't ambitious enough. So I said, what would I really desperately like to build? By the way, I asked Elon to give us a free Falcon Heavy launch, and his response was, it's not a priority for us to answer this question. We're going to Mars. Well, it's very likely in some biologist's view that 5 years after you go to Mars, no one is alive. Okay. Yeah, the real question is, are you going to sterilize everyone who goes? If they're pregnant on the way, or they get pregnant when they're there and they have a child, what is that child going to do growing up in 38% of a G? You can fix everything else about Mars. Right? You can dig 7 meters down so you can deal with the radiation, which is worse than the moon. You can never go outside so you don't have to deal with the perchlorates in the soil. You can you can have solar power plants, nuclear power plants, or whatever to get your energy. You cannot change the G. There's no practical way to do that. Anyway, so I said, what about, given how cheap Falcon Heavy launches are and the fact that the New Glenn is coming along and it's going to be even more competitive on a pound, dollars per pound of delivered payload to orbit, what if we did something where we spun the entire station to get the G that we want? So this is a two launch system. Okay. It uses an expandable boom. These are used quite frequently on spacecraft of one type or another, a lot on ISS, and inflatable cores that allow you to communicate between like a habitation and a commons deck here. So once this mast is expanded, you now can get to the Mars G lab. The mast expands again, you can get to the lunar G lab. The mast expands again, you can get to the hub. And then you mate the hub here, and you've got a long tunnel to a storage counterweight. And that's how you get your artificial G. So you do two launches with Falcon Heavies or New Glenns. You rendezvous in orbit. This is you launch perhaps 30 days apart. These are uncrewed launches. You come together in an automated fashion, dock. You extend the mass and you spin up. And instantly, you have the elements of Space Station 5. You have the first structure of Space Station 5. And you can add to this. You could go out. And then you can, of course, build around. So this is ridiculously ambitious, unless some Silicon Valley or Seattle or New York billionaire wants to fund it. On the other hand, it will cost less to do this than one flight of SLS. Literally one flight of SLS. This is cheaper. And if you weigh the benefit from doing one flight of SLS against the benefit of answering the most fundamental question about human biology and space that there is, I think the answer is pretty obvious what you need to do. So I would close this part of the talk by saying that Jerry Pournelle, back when he ran the Citizens Space Advisory Council, National Space Advisory Council, of which I was proud to be a member, and we used to advise President Reagan once a year for 8 years on what the U.S. should be doing in space. The opening cover letter that Jerry would send along with this information to the president said, had the tagline, "The politician the statesman who takes humanity into space permanently will be remembered when Isabella the Great is long forgotten. Because this is a future for humanity that stretches out not just hundreds or thousands of years, but millions, right, once you get off planet. So my view is the entrepreneur, the billionaire, the philanthropist who funds the G-Lab and puts it into practice, their name will go down in history along with the Armstrong and Aldrin and Collins as taking the first major step off this planet. So I'd just like now to close with a couple of slides from our Exotic Propulsion Initiative. And I caution you, I'm not a physicist. Okay, I started by saying I'm a rocket plumber. That's exactly what I am. We deal with, you know, cold liquids and hot gases. And really, that's pretty straightforward stuff. Everyone talks about rocket science. I talk about rocket engineering. So I'm completely out of my depth when it comes to the exotic propulsion. But I do know a couple of things. One is, if you do not free yourself from the tyranny of the rocket equation at some point in the future, where space will always be too expensive for us to really build a civilization around. All right. You have to be able not only to take people off the surface of the Earth and take them to space, to free space, you also have to return raw materials and goods that you're selling. There's a certain degree of intercourse that has to happen between what amounts to the colonies and the mother world. Earth will be the center of the solar system for thousands of years to come. But you know, if the rocket equation drives everything we do, and chemical propulsion, you know, which I've spent 50 years of my life trying to mature, if chemical propulsion is all that we have left, we're going to be in a world of hurt. Right? So we have to rise above that. Arthur Clarke used to call it, you know, we need to invent a space drive. And I grew up reading that and wondering how in heck do you do it. I actually have a personal anecdote about that. I first met Sir Arthur back in 1972 at his club in London. I was 22, and a friend of his had badgered him into seeing me. And we had a great time. We actually, his dinner engagement that night got canceled, so I spent most of the evening talking to him. And he asked me why I got interested in space. And I said, well, it was because of Profiles of the Future, which he wrote in 1960 and I read when I was 10. And there was a chapter in the book called Space the Unconquerable, where at the end of it, he's talking about the vast distances and interstellar flight and so on. And he says, when you're next out of doors on a summer eve, turn your head towards the zenith. There shining above you brightly will be the brilliant blue-white beacon of Vega. At 26 light years, near enough the point of no return for us short-lived humans, because no man will ever turn homeward from beyond Vega to greet those he knew and loved on Earth. Obviously, at speed of light and back, you're talking more than half a century. And I said, much more politely than this, that pissed me off. I was 10. You don't tell a 10-year-old you're not going to be able to do something. And he looked at me as a 22-year-old and he said, well, you know, you may have the chance, but it's going to take a space drive. And I said, how do you invent a space drive? You know, you've got a degree in physics. Tell me how to do this. And he said, I don't know. He said, but what you need to do is you need to find a physicist who will give you a straight answer to the question, what is inertia? Okay, that sounds good. So I found one, and that's how the Exotic Propulsion Initiative started. So a number of people have raised the possibility of propellantless propulsion. I mean, actually, there have been hundreds of folks over the years trying to work on it. Most have been bogus. Most are frankly garbage. But every so often, a few pop up that physicists have difficulty explaining what's going on. One of those, of course, is the Scheuer M drive. Another is the work replicating the Scheuer M drive that NASA did at Johnson Space Center at Eagle Works. I funded the original Eagle Works when it was a private company, but when I ran out of my resources, they ended up at NASA Johnson Space Center and did a fine job with this replication. There's another company called Kena, which I believe comes from, I Kena give you no more power from the engines, Captain. That's actually where the name originates. This is a device very similar to the M drive. And then there are a bunch of amateur efforts. And by amateur, I don't mean to denigrate them in any way. These are sort of the classical amateurs who go out and spend $50,000 doing an experiment, building exotic equipment in their garage having custom laboratories built and so forth. And several of those people came together in a workshop that the Space Studies Institute invited workshop we held in September of last year. And this is the group, and it includes everything from amateur researchers to professors of physics, NASA scientists, and so forth. And a proceedings is now available, a free PDF. You can go to our website, ssi.org, and download the proceedings and read it at your leisure. And hopefully you will get more out of it than I do, especially if you have a physics background. But it's generally fascinating stuff. And the upshot of the results of this workshop are that there have been multiple replications of devices that shouldn't seemingly work as we currently understand physics. But they do not, and I want to emphasize this, they're not operating outside the bounds of physics. If they're real, you know, one experiment trumps 1,000 theories. So if the data is real, and of course they're operating way down, almost close to the noise level, but if it's real, then we have to build theories that explain how they work consistent with what we know of general relativity, Newtonian physics, and quantum physics. And I have no doubt that's possible because I've seen the mathematicians and the theorists go to the board and explain how systems would work. There's a lot of knee-jerk, well, this breaks the laws of physics, or this violates conservation momentum, and so forth. And my attitude about that is, look at the data first, get smart about it, and then be a critic. I don't mind critics. We make progress with critics, but you don't just mouth off and say it doesn't work because of conservation momentum. Because going back to what Arthur said about inertia, the guy who gave me the first straight answer to that was Jim Woodward, who came up with what's called Mach effect propulsion, based on Mach's principle, which Einstein had originally incorporated in general relativity. He has a number of peer-reviewed publications, conference publications, and then he published a book several years ago, which he very graciously gave the royalties to the Space Studies Institute to continue work on exotic propulsion. And if you really want to understand this business, go to boingboing.net. Charles Platt wrote a very, very nice article in 2014 that does a much better job describing Mach effect propulsion than I could ever hope to do. So just type in strange thrust and boing boing, and you will, it's the first hit that you get. So the Woodward Fern Lab, Jim Woodward's colleague Heidi Fern, who trained under Peter Maloney as a quantum physicist, a theorist principally, is located at Cal State Fullerton in Southern California. And I've been there dozens of times now and observed the Mach effect device in action. The signal is sufficiently above the noise level that I think there's a real effect happening. There's a good theory that both Jim and Heidi have developed over the years that incorporates Hoyle-Narlikar gravity, advanced and retarded waves out of Wheeler-Feynman, and inertia updated Mach effect or Mach theory out of Dennis Sciama from the early 1950s. So these are not trivial physicists who have worked on it, and neither are Woodward and Fern. They're competent physicists. They have something that I won't say is inexplicable, because I believe it is explainable in the context of modern physics, and especially general relativity. I wouldn't be working on it if I didn't think that was the case. But we're still not at the point where we can turn this into a propulsion system. It's pure R&D, but it deserves R&D. And so I'll leave you with a quote from Galileo Galilei when he was shown the instruments of torture as if they were about to be used by the Pope and the Inquisition, unless he recanted Copernican astronomy. And of course, he thought about it for a microsecond or two and signed his name and said, yeah, you're right, I'm wrong, no problem. But it is said that on his deathbed, in Italian, he said, nevertheless, it moves. And he's talking, of course, about the Earth moving around the sun. So for many, many years, Jim's research, he would turn on this device, he would get a single pulse out of it, the device would overheat some, and he would do things like, you know, flip the orientation so that you aren't getting Lorentz forces involved in it, you're not getting disturbances from trucks driving by the lab, and all sorts of things to reduce the noise signature. And I said, Jim, this is all great, even though the thrust is on the order of, you know, a fly's wings beating. I mean, it's a really, really small number. I said, can you make it do that thrust twice? Because this is an episodic thing. You take a stack of piezoelectric discs, you apply a voltage, you scrunch them, you raise their internal energy, and then you accelerate them. You have to do both of those things, and you have to do it in resonance. It's darn tricky. And he said, well, he said, I'll have to rewrite the code. This was on a Monday. And on a Wednesday, I get an email. And now there are five pulses. And they're all the same. And what he had done is he had rewritten the code, and he had changed the way the voltage ramps in the system to a quadratic ramp instead of just a linear one. And that solved his heating problem. And boom. Thrust. And this is just extraordinary to me. This is last August. I don't have an answer for it. Okay. When Heidi or Jim or others, John Kramer, the University of Washington, great quantum physicist, explains it to me, for a moment I understand it. Okay. And when people say, this violates conservation momentum, I say, really, how's that the case? Well, you've got this device and it's moving, but it's, you know, it can't move as the single device. I said, okay, what if you draw the box not around this device, but you draw the box around the universe? Momentum is conserved within that box if the inertial mass of this object is communicating with the mass of the distant stars. That's Mach's principle. Is that, yeah, when I push on this, setting aside friction, this, through gravito-inertial radiation, is talking to the distant stars, it's responding to it. And then, of course, the question is, well, how can you do that without violating speed of light and information transfer between these bodies, you know, 13 billion years into the past. And they also have an answer to that, which is, again, consistent with modern physics, and that's the Wheeler-Feynman interpretation of advanced and retarded waves. And there is no way in hell I'm going to explain that to you. But if you're interested in the subject, there's plenty of literature out there that allows you to explore it further. So I will leave you with one last slide. And this is, to my mind, totally mind-blowing and extraordinary. This is the equation that Woodward developed about 20, 25 years ago. Again, based purely on general relativity. There's no magic, there's no mysticism in here. This is pure physics. And it's published in peer review literature. This is where the Mach devices work. Okay. They're basically impulse engines. You know, one half impulse power, Mr. Sulu. That's what they are. There's another term which is normally ignored in the calculations, like power calculations and so on. And that's this term. Jim calls it the wormhole term. And the reason it's normally ignored is that it's typically down at the level of one. When you do you substitute all the numbers, you basically, you know, it doesn't change this result at all. But the wormhole term suggests the possibility of negative mass. If you know anything about warp drives, faster than light, and jump gates, i.e. actual stargates, you know that they only work if you have negative mass. And for a normal sized stargate, you would need negative mass about equivalent to that of Jupiter. Right. And we have no clue how to make negative mass. And we certainly have no clue how to get a Jupiter-sized negative mass into something the size of, you know, that you can walk through. But with this wormhole term, the suggestion is that the amounts of mass now come down to tons or kilotons, i.e., you can potentially build a ship around it, and you could warp space and time sufficient to literally open up a jump gate. And again, this is not pure craziness. Now, one in a thousand physicists will tell you that there's a chance of doing this, but there are a few that will. And I was at a conference again with Friedman Dyson and others a few years ago at University of California, San Diego, where John Kramer, a noted quantum physicist, explained how you would do exactly this, quoting Woodward. So when I heard that, you know, my eyebrows went up a little bit and my spidey sense began tingling, and I said, somebody needs to be foolish enough to put money into this, because if you don't, if you're so afraid that you're going to fail, that you will not even look, you will never get an answer. So I'm at the end of my career, so I don't care about people saying that was stupid, because they've said that through the last 50 years of my entrepreneurial commercial space lifetime. And now we can say, well, you know, there's Elon and there's Bezos and others, and, you know, they had what I didn't have, which was lots and lots of money. So I wasn't wrong about that. I was just too early. I may be wrong about this. I don't care if I am. But because if we don't do it, as far as I can see, nobody else will. So once again, the Space Studies Institute, just like it led with Lunar Prospector and led with the mass driver work and so forth, we're taking a step into the unknown, unafraid of the ridicule that might attend. Because if it works, you know, it changes the future of humanity in space. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to try and answer any questions you might have. Beer.
Sean. What about use of the Dragon Lab?
That's a possibility. We think it would get us partway to the answer, but by no means the whole answer. So instead of Dragon Lab, which doesn't actually seem to be going anywhere within SpaceX, what we have done is we actually have worked a little with NanoRacks, talking about the possibility of using either Cygnus or HTV out of the Japanese, because the Japanese do have a decided interest in gravitational biology. So they would likely be supportive of this. So those conversations are ongoing, but the most that we could probably get is a few months of exposure, so we might not be able to get more than one generation raised. It's better than nothing, you know, and it's probably a $30 to $50 million experiment rather than a multi-hundred million dollar one. Yes, sir.
It seems like you're a little down on planetary exploration, but the spaceships that you're interested in developing seems like they could be a benefit to that. In other words, having one that's outside of Mars to benefit the Martians that will be living there on Venus.
I think that there are reasons to go to Mars. I don't think they're to build a second civilization on Mars. I think you go to Mars because it's like the Grand Canyon. It's going to be the most spectacular sight to stand at the Valley of Mariner and try and see the other side, okay? Or look at Olympus Mons, walk up Olympus Mons if you're, at 38% of a G, you might be able to do it. I think there are science reasons to go, the question of life and all this sort of thing. But I just go back to the old rock song, Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kids.
But your space stations would be great in terms of them being able to go up and then reconvene with gravity.
Well, science fiction writers have talked about, I'm trying to remember, I think it was Larry Niven who had confinement asteroid. I mean, that old Victorian term for when a woman is pregnant, is confined. Well, you might send pregnant females to a 1G station so that they can bear the child. But then the real question is the child growing up. Okay, what happens to, your calcium metabolism goes all wonky. Your eyeballs' fluid distribution changes. There are people who are, ophthalmologists who are arguing that you might go blind after a couple of years in zero G. I'm not saying we don't go to a planetary surface. Answer the question. Spend a little bit of money. Don't say it's not a priority. Okay? Spend the money. Answer the question. And if the question is that we can live in 15% G, and all that happens is we get long and spindly and all look like ballet dancers or something, that's fine. Great. But I say it's immoral where we are today, talking about putting 100,000 people a year on Mars and not knowing the answer to this most fundamental and simple to ascertain. It takes us 10 years. Less than $1 billion, less than 10 years to answer that damn question, and then move on. Once you've done it, you either open space for all time, or you say, we can't go to planetary surfaces, so let's not spend too much effort on that except, as National Geographic, right? And then let's figure out how humanity expands into the cosmos. Yes?
You briefly mentioned the resource prospector.
Yeah.
How far along is the rover in terms of design? Is it ready to go to Johnson Space Center for a space-going vehicle yet? Or how far has NASA Ames come along with
that? What's that, the lunar?
The lunar resource prospector.
Well, that actually flew in, 1992 or so.
The prospector rover that's so far, planned for 2020 to go to the...
I have no idea. I don't follow the... I won't say that NASA's no longer relevant to me, but it's no offense to all of you who may work there, but it really isn't, so I've kind of gone beyond that. But I would be very interested in what happens with that, because the water ice issue on the moon. I mean, if you could live on the moon, and even if you can't, that water ice may be the most accessible in the near term, say over the next 2-3 decades before we start moving some comets or whatever. So I'm all in favor of answering that question.
So I worked on Resource Prospector.
Good.
And so the current plan is to launch on the SLICM2 mission, which is nominally August 2021, February 2022, somewhere in that time frame. Yeah. So it would be a co-manifest on that flight of the SLS. Yeah, depending on where it goes, it's going to go to the North Pole or the South Pole.
So that SLS mission, it's a Libration 1 or Libration 2 point mission? Is that what happens? And then you just drop off and...
We would drop off as, right after they pop the capsule off the rocket. About an hour later, we would pop off just because they want to have enough space and
bang the
capsule.
So, and that would fly in 2021, you say?
Yeah, cool. With the new administration and the push for the moon and all that kind of stuff, and maybe putting people on the EM-1, there's questions about, what's the actual timing, but as of a month ago, anyway, that was the plan.
Very nice. Thank you. Yes, sir?
So, I'm not related to space industry, but... The common man, even to me, the propulsion technology at this point in time seems to be way more higher priority than the artificial gravity. It does appear to be that way.
I wouldn't disagree with you. However, the amount of money, if I was infinitely wealthy, or just, let's say I'm 1/10 of an Elon wealthy, I don't think I could throw enough money into the propulsion work for the people who are there to absorb it to move much faster than they're currently moving. I mean, we spend a few tens of thousands of dollars a year right now on the propulsion work. We could probably spend $1 million. We might be able to spend $2 million. We can't spend 100, simply because it would take years just to educate the physicists to think properly about the particular problem. Whereas the gravitational biology stuff, there's no new physics to it. It's just, just engineering and just get it done. But it means, a lot of people at CAD terminals drawing nuts and bolts and actually building things, so that sucks up money pretty fast. But I think they're both equally valid. At the moment I don't have enough money to do anything in the gravitational biology. I'm just stalled until somebody wants to write a $2 million check so we can get into our phase A study. And on the propulsion side, I do get contributions. I mean, we had somebody do a little Kickstarter in Finland, of all places, a year ago, and sent us $5,000, which was put to good use in the lab. So if I could get a few $100,000 for the propulsion work, we'd be doing great, because we could fund some of these amateurs again, the skilled amateurs, we could fund them for $50,000 a year, so that they don't have to work at another job. They could just work full time on their stuff. Yes, sir?
There are maddeningly vague reports coming out of China that they either have launched or intend to launch.
I've heard them. Yeah. Well, I have heard that they did launch. I've heard that they might launch. I've heard that we don't know what anybody's talking. I mean, I've heard everything. And so I'm like a man with three watches. I do not know what time it is in China.
Sorry. Yeah, and I probably don't know anymore. I heard that they did launch, that they put it on their most recent space station, and that it worked. And I haven't heard anything.
Yeah, I've heard that same story. We may have gotten it in the same place. NASAspaceflight.com, if you know it, is a really good source of the exotic propulsion work, both Woodward stuff and M-Drive. And some people, Woodward himself, thinks that the M-Drive is explainable by Mach effects theory. So, you know, it might just be a different instantiation of the basic concept. Yes?
Going back to GLAB, why does it have to be so big?
Well, very long ago, this is really long ago, this is a half a century ago, I worked in a microbiology lab at a university. And my job was to thymectomize mice, newborns. A newborn mouse is about that big. And their thymus is about the size of a grain of rice. It's actually huge compared to their body, but it's still a really tricky job. That's when I learned I was never going to be a surgeon because of the small amount of tremor I've got. But I had intimate acquaintance with animal care. And yes, mice are only this big, so they need relatively small centrifuges. The prospect of trying to deal with those mice in a 100% teleoperated mode, that is with no humans around, is beyond my ability to figure out how to engineer. I know that there are AI folks out there who say, oh yeah, no problem, we can make it happen. I don't believe them, okay? Just dealing with bedding changes, you know, mouse pellets, mouse urine. Talk to the astronauts who came back from the space lab mission where they had mice on board. There are mice on board at ISS. A lot of effort goes into just that maintenance. If you don't have a human being there with their hands, I think you have a problem. And now everything becomes human-sized. So, I can do a little Discover biolab thing, you know, this big, put a couple of newborns in it, let them go through a month in zero G or partial G or whatever, and bring them back, you know, euthanize them, bring them back frozen or whatever. But that's not going to answer the real long-term questions. So I think everything gets built around a human scale. And that's why I think our 2012 free flyer was the smallest, almost the smallest that you could do.
Yeah. So, how about exercise? Can exercise make up for the missing?
No. We've spent now, what, 400 million years learning how to be creatures in a 1G environment. So all of our metabolism, as we came out of the zero-G environment of the water, all of our metabolism is keyed to gravity. The way our bones sequester and release calcium into the body, and as the calcium molecules move through the circulation, how they signal and affect your immune system and, you know, your arteries and everything else, this exercise alone is not going to help that. I mean, on ISS, they're exercising 2 to 4 hours a day, and they're spending a third of their waking hours exercising, and it's still not fixing the problem.
Or something like a very dull swim, a couple of hours a day.
Yeah, everything we've been able to tell, and again, we have so little knowledge about this, is that you really need to have close to permanent sustained 1G. You might be able, say, traveling to Mars, to mitigate some of the effects of zero gravity by sleeping in a rotating swing type or a centrifuge type thing. I mean, people at MIT have explored this, but that's not, I mean, you can't live like that. I mean, you can't have a normal human environment, you know, you're just not, that's going to work for exploration missions, but it's not going to work for permanent human settlement. Yes, sir.
How do you think everything with Jerry O'Neill, the way he was thinking 40 years ago, what do you think, I guess, how well are his thoughts still holding up today?
You know, it's a little funny. I would have thought, you know, after 40 years, certainly things are going to be dated. But when I go back and read his thoughts, in many cases he was remarkably prescient about, or at least insightful about the potential of humanity in space and what it could mean for our evolution as a species. So I think most of his stuff holds up pretty well. Now, for example, just to pick a nit with him, you know, he had ideas for very large windows in the settlements with mirrors that would bring in sunlight and with a fairly elaborate way to make sure you had the proper day-dark cycles and so forth. And any engineer will, you know, big glass mirrors under pressure, it gives us the willies. You know, even if it's only 15 PSI, it's frightening. So I think settlements of the future actually will have no windows, because one thing he probably couldn't have envisioned, we don't have one here. Normally at this point, I point to, you know, the 4K display that's on the wall. They're now building cruise ships where every cabin in the cruise ship has an outside view. That's because it's an artificial outside view. You know, they make windows and they put a 4K TV system in it and they couple a camera on the outside of the ship. And so the ship moves, you see the water move, all the motions are right. Now in a rotating station, you know, you're looking out the window and if there are things out there, they're rotating past you and this screws up your vestibular senses. But now you can just de-spin that electronically. You know, the signal just gets processed and you see, it's a Star Trek universe. You see the outside world. I mean, I always thought it was amusing, you know, you've got the Enterprise with, especially the Enterprise D with these huge massive windows, you know, and they have structural integrity fields to hold the ship together. Right, and they can handle hundreds of G's of acceleration, you know, because of inertial dampers and so forth. Yet they got big giant windows. Right? No, you're not going to have big giant windows. You're going to build concrete space settlements for shielding. You're going to spin the inside stuff. You're going to have electronic windows, I think, and you're going to be able literally to dial in whatever environment you want. You want virtual reality? You're going to get virtual reality in a physical built environment. But I encourage you to read The High Frontier. We make it available free once a year, but okay. And so I would urge you to read The High Frontier and 2081, which we're going to try and Kindle. Yes, sir.
Actually, I have two questions. If that's okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
All right. One, I remember reading Mary Roach, and she talked about
yes, Mary,
other ways of doing low gravity medical situations, like lying prostrate for months at a time.
Right.
That's short term. Is there, obviously you can't tell mice to not move in laying beds, but has there been given a thought to how to approach this sideways as opposed to going up?
Yeah, we haven't found a way yet. I love her stuff. I think that that the bed rest approach has real value for, again, exploratory missions, you know, where you're going to Mars or you're going to do a 6 month stay on ISS or something and you use bed rest as the simulation of what you're going to encounter. But I don't think it's going to work. I can't talk the little buggers into staying in bed. They just run. And you had
The other one was Carl Sagan quote, "It's not us that'll make Delta Centauri and the nearby stars, but a species very like us." And I always thought that was going to be, you know, aspirational and everything mm-hmm. else.
Right.
But with the upcoming medical advances and re-engineering the genes, do you think there's a possibility that it really won't be us that go photo stars. It'll be an improved version of us that has ocular reinforcements and
grease. Possibly, but so I'm going to take, most of you have probably heard of anti-aging research that's going on, including in this valley, like Aubrey de Grey and the Sense Foundation, Strategies for Engineered Negligible Senescence. My day job is actually, I'm the CEO of a biotech company working to make the removal of senescent cells from human beings a practical reality. I also have a space company, but the lesson from that aging research is that there are lots of folks working on trying to halt aging or slow it. This involves tinkering with metabolism, which is 20 or 30,000 genes, hundreds of thousands of proteins, and evolutionary biology that has evolved over 2 billion years since the advent of the mitochondria entering, the alpha protobacterium entering the first eukaryotic cells. It's bloody difficult to mess with that. I mean, Freeman and I used to have arguments about this very point, or friendly discussions, I should say, where he thinks, we'll use synthetic biology and we'll grow trees to collect, that can live in a vacuum and collect sunlight. And he's right. Someday humanity will figure that out. I don't think that day is anywhere near term. So I think that I don't want to mess with metabolism. I want to copy what nature has, how we've evolved within nature, and use that to our best efforts to go into space now. And 1,000 or 1,000,000 years from now, I don't know when, Olaf Stapledon, Last and First Man, Arthur Clarke, City in the Stars, they, engineered away fingernails and other parts of the human anatomy. Read the book to find out. We will do these things, I think, at some point. But, if we're nothing more than the bridge between that human being and ourselves, and where we came from 200,000 years ago, let's live the best life we can with the engineering skills we have today. And we have those skills right today. Thank you again very much, Rick and Sean.